We thank you that you give us direction and what to say and do. And we just commit this into your hands, have your perfect will and your perfect way in all of our lives. And we ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Pastor Rod wanted to say that his presentation is in PowerPoint. And if you just, if we do what?
If you want a copy, leave your email.
Yeah, leave an email to him and he will get you to get him a copy of it, okay? And so everybody get handouts. You should have two of them. We got two pieces of paper there.
Yep.
Handouts. There's a on one, the one that says sources on it. Where it says sources on it. The page where I talk about sources, I have Bibles, it has all the scriptures on that page. Do you see that one?
Yeah.
Because I'm giving you the source of the material that I use. I left one off that I wanted to add. And so, and I'd already printed them all off. So I thought, oh, well, we can just have to write them on. But the material that was also used was by Jonathan Davis. And the name of the book is called The History of Welsh Baptist. And it was first published in 1835. So, I find amazing. God is in awe of how God works and how he does. And I was telling Rod, I started down the same path to do what he was doing, and God stopped me. And it was a great presentation. Well, now I know why. It would have just been a duplication of the same thing. God said, no, I'm going to take you a different direction, a different way. I'm going to talk about my history a little bit. For those, most of you know me, that you attend here. Everyone just assumes that Greg and I are, Greg's an ordained Southern Baptist.
Amen.
And so that's why I've been cut to talk about this subject. I know it well. Because I'm an ordained Free Will Baptist.
Yeah.
You didn't know they existed, did you?
No.
But they're own denomination. And in this country, they go back to the early 1500s. And they go back to Wells. And have a history all the way back to the when the error came in of free will, and that's what I would use the term, when that error began to infiltrate the Welsh Baptist movement, that was 411 AD. So it's a movement that goes from now all the way back to 411 AD. Okay, so kind of know that I've taken this a little different. That's not my slide. There it is. I took this a little different to talk about free will versus predestination. I see that as apples and oranges. And mostly, especially in the church today, when we talk about free will, the conversation they really want to have is predestination and election. Is really the conversation they want. But if you're going to counterpoint free will, I believe it's versus the sovereignty of God. Now, as I lay this out, I'm going to talk about these things. We're going to talk about the Arminian and Calvinism and go this whole circle. But I'm going to save the sovereignty of God for very last. That will take us full circle. So, the next slide, please. Arminianism is a teaching regarding salvation associated with a Dutch theologian. His name was James Arminius. I'm just getting tongue-tied here. He went by Jacob, but he lived 1560 through 1609. And the fundamental principle in Arminianism is the rejection of absolute predestination. See, both sides teach predestination. They just see it in a different way. Is the rejection of absolute predestination and an affirmation of the freedom of the human will. And so, next slide, please. After the death of Arminius, the groups became to be called Arminians. And they presented a statement to the governing authorities of Holland, in which they set forth five articles of doctrine that they presented to Holland. And let's go to the next slide, please. One, that the divine decree of predestination is conditional, not absolute. Number two, that the atonement is by intention universal. In other words, it's the idea that Everyone can be saved. Huh? Everyone can come to salvation. Number three, that man cannot of himself exercise a saving faith, but requires God's help to attain this faith. Now, this is amazing because this is what we believe, the Calvinist side. The Arminian side today does not believe that. Now, the reason I'm using the treatise of the faith and practice of Free Will Baptists is very old. It's very old. Because all these ideas have gotten mixed up over time. Today you talk about Calvinism, you say, oh, what, how many points are you? Are you a 5-point Calvinist, or are you a 2-point Calvinist, or a 3-point Calvinist? We've gotten, and if the ones that say they're 2 and 3 is because they blended Arminianism into their ideas, and we got an amalgamation of all this stuff in the churches. And originally, though, Arminius, he was schooled in the Reformation thinking. He was schooled in Calvinism. John Arminius was the student of Theodore Beza, which was the son-in-law to John Calvin. And Theodore Beza, and I'm not going to get off on this tangent, but I'm going to give you a million-dollar word, okay? Supralapsarianism versus infralapsarianism. And I promise I'm not going to go down this road. But I wanted to touch on it because I got a joke in my tail. Those are huge words. Supra means before. Lap means before the fall. That God chose before the fall. Infra says, no, he didn't. He chose after the fall. And there's a whole teaching on all this, okay? So we can take this either to a whole other level on this thing. But the joke is that Martin Luther was in a group of theologians, and they were having this conversation about supralapsarianism and infralapsarianism. And Martin Luther just sat back and was listening. And one of them said, well, Martin, what's your understanding of what God was doing before the creation? Of course, this is tongue-in-cheek, okay? And he said, I believe he was creating hell for theologians that ask these kind of questions. And we laugh at that, but there comes a point, that there's some truth in that too, that we can get ourselves so far out there. Okay? And I want to touch it there because number three has changed in Arminianism today. And I'm going to tell you why and how it gets there. You'll see by the time we get done. Number four. That though the grace of God is a necessary condition of human effort, it does not act irresistibly in man. In other words, it's what Rod talked about. And when God calls in God's will, it isn't an irresistible grace. In other words, they're going to come to him no matter what. They're saying, no, that's not true. Number five, that believers are able to resist sin, but are not beyond the possibility of falling from grace. Next slide, please. The Dutch government convened to hear all of this that the Arminians were putting forth, and it was called the National Synod. A synod is an assembly of, in this case, it was an assembly of clergy, an assembly of theologians that took these points and they looked at them. And that was in 1618 through 19. It fell across into 2 years. It was called the Synod of Dart. Dart was part of the word of the city they met in. It's a word you can't even hardly say. It's easy to say Synod of Dart. This assembly of clergy and this place of Dart, and they came together to take a look at what the Arminians were presenting. And the members adopted 5 points in direct opposition to the 5 articles of the Arminians. And they have come to be known as the 5 points of Calvinism. Many of you can say what that is. What would the word be?
Tulip.
Tulip. There you go. Next slide, please. Tulip. Next slide. T stands for total depravity. The U is unconditional election. The L is limited atonement. The I is irresistible grace, and the P See, in my background in coming from the free will side, my instinct is to say the perseverance of the saints. No, it's the P stands for the preservation of the saints. And it's what Rod talked about. Father, I thank you for all those that you have placed in my hands, and I have not lost one. Okay? But it came to be known as TULIP. And the Calvinists like that. They embrace this word. Next slide, please. Calvinists adopted the TULIP acronym to explain their position. But the Synod also assigned an acronym to explain the Arminian position, which you don't hear much about. It's called LILAC, which the Arminians say misrepresents their position. But I'm going to show you today that it does not, why through the doctrine and through the faith and practice of one of the oldest Arminian churches in this country, the National Association of Free Will Baptists. The L in LILAC means limited depravity. In other words, we're not totally depraved, and we're going to get into this. The I is I elect God. God didn't elect me. I chose him. And thus, when I chose him, he chose me. The L, limitless atonement. It's not limited. It's limitless based on those who will believe. Our restable grace and carnal security. You say, what? And I'm going to get into that later. Okay, next slide, please. Pelagius. This doctrine started in the 5th century, the 400s. Pelagius says this: we are capable of obedience. And he goes on, next slide, please. He was born in Britain in 354 AD. He became a monk, date and place unknown. He resides in Rome for the fall of 410. His death, there's some say 420, but there's others that argue that, so I just put date and place on them. But in his thinking and in his defense, this was where the faith began to get off course. Now, and if you get that book that I'm talking about from Jonathan Davis, A History of the Welsh Baptists, he gets into this extensively. Because the Welsh Baptist movement, there's an oral tradition, there's others that shoot at it, but I'm going to throw it out there anyway. If you want to look it up and kind of dig at it yourself, you can. This man's name was Pudens, P-U-D-E-N-S, and his wife's name was Claudia. If you put Pudens and Claudia, 63 AD, in the computer, you'll get an article on all of this stuff. And there was those that had a dispute, but this idea that was something was taught to me. I came to faith in Free Will Baptist. I came to saving grace of Jesus Christ when I was 17 years old. Yeah, the Arminians were teaching a born-again experience. My life was transferred and changed. And God, through time, showed me this is not the way to go. But in 63 A.D., they say Pudens and Claudia, she was relatives to Caesar at the time, went to Rome and met with a man by the name of Apostle Paul that was in a rented house in 63 A.D. and came to faith and brought it back to Wells. And it was pretty well uninterrupted from 63 A.D. to 186 A.D. to when the Caesar at the time said, no, we've got to stop this. They're, what those pagans are doing in Wells, we've got to stop it. And great persecution started to the church. And then by 411 A.D. is when Pelagianism began to take hold, and there was a great split in what went on to be known as the Welsh Baptist movement. And part of the movement stayed Welsh Baptist, and the others became Free Will Baptists. There was a great split. So it has a history that goes all the way. It has a history back, if indeed that oral tradition is true, it goes all the way back to Jesus Christ, through the Apostle Paul, through Pudens and Claudia, and up through today. And then they talk about in the book written by Jonathan Davis, The History of the Welsh Baptists, when the error of Pelagius was injected into their movement. Because he was from Britain. Next slide, please. Pelagius was aroused to anger. I'm being a little bit offensive why he started down this thinking. Pelagius was aroused to anger by Christendom. They excused themselves by pleading, I'm so frail, I can't do it, I'm sinful. And he's watching all these people that claim to be believers and they were on a roller coaster ride with the flesh. The frailty of the flesh and the impossibility of fulfilling the grievous commandments of God. And he saw this and he reacted to this, and he said, in view of his times, he began to preach that God commanded nothing impossible to do. That man possessed the power of doing the good if he only willed. And the weakness of the flesh was merely a pretext to sin. Next slide, please. The controlling principle of Pelagius' thought was the conviction that God never commands what is impossible for man to perform. In words, if God declared this and said, this is what I want you to do, then he gives you the avenue and the means to do it. He doesn't give a command that man cannot perform. Next slide, please. For Pelagius, nature does not require grace to fulfill its obligations. Free will properly exercises produces virtue, which is the supreme good and is justly followed by reward. By his own effort, free will, man can achieve whatever is required of him in morality and religion. If that was true, why do we need a savior? Next slide, please. Pelagius rooted his view of human nature and free will in his doctrine of creation. Man has the freedom of choice and the absolute equal ability at every moment to do good or evil. We know the story of Adam and Eve. They could not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Because right now they only have knowledge of good. Pelagius says that when they ate from that tree of the knowledge of good and evil, nature did not change. Knowledge did. He has now the knowledge of good added to it the knowledge of evil. And now there's a choice to be made. But his nature did not change. Next slide, please. He defines sin as a willingness to do what righteousness forbids. So sin is always an act, never a nature. Pelagius insisted of sinful acts can never cause a sinful nature, nor can evil be inherited. In other words, we pass down the sin nature from generation to generation. Adam's children, were born in sin. He said, no, they were born perfect just like Adam was. Pelagius insisted sinful acts can never cause a sinful nature, nor can evil be inherited. If they could, then the goodness and righteousness of God are destroyed. So there was his thinking and theology. Next slide, please. His counterpart at that time, what Pastor Rod touched on, is, I'm going to say Augustine or Augustine. And he was the counterpoint saying, no, 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 no. But this will of free will, okay? Now I have the choice of good, and I have the choice of evil, and I have the freedom to make that choice. Augustine said, it was by the evil use of his free will that man destroyed both it and himself. In other words, what they're saying and teaching is free will did exist. Adam and Eve was the perfect creation. They had a free will choice to make. They made the wrong one, and in the process of doing that, destroyed their free will and themselves in the process, because now they are affected by a sin nature. And it suggests, Augustine said, if they are infected by a sin nature, and they're corrupted by a sin nature, and they're depraved by a sin nature, then you cannot have free will because that sinful nature gets in the way. True statement. Next slide, please. I brought this for the reason because I'm quoting from the Free Will Baptist article. This is a treatise of the faith and practices of the National Association of Free Will Baptists. 78 pages. Aren't you glad we're not going to go through them one by one? Yeah. Boring stuff for the most part. But I picked out from the teaching, from the doctrine, the points to be made. And yes, they will say, well, the free will of the church, the Arminian church I went to didn't teach it that. It's been messed up and mixed up for all these years. But what makes this so amazing that this has a history that goes back to the 1500s in this country and goes back into Wales, even back to 400. And so, the Free Will Baptist treatise, I'm going to quote from it from time to time, and so get you to see what the Arminians do say. The Free Will Baptist treatise of faith, Article of Faith, number 10, Freedom of the Will, says this. The human will is free and self-control, having power to yield to the influence of the truth and the Spirit, or resist them and perish. Next slide, please. Predestination. I said both sides teach us predestination. That's why I set it up the way I did, free will to the sovereignty of God. There's a predestination and election I'm keeping separate, because predestination, Calvinism says that God predestined man. Arminianism said no, God predestined a plan. Next slide, please. They both pick Isaiah 46:10. They both sides refer to this scripture and use it to make their point, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure. Calvinists will say that God saw the end from the beginning. He looked down through time. He chose those in time that he put into his plan by his divine election. He chose man from each generation all the way to the end, and those are the elect. The Arminian view says no. God looked down through time. He was able to declare the end from the beginning. He looked down through time, and he put a plan of salvation in place, that whosoever believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. He put that plan in place. They looked down through the portal. God looked down through the portal of time and saw everybody that chose him by their own free will, and he knew every one of those going to come to him. Because they chose him, he called them the elect. And there's the two views. Next slide, please. Election. Arminian view taken from the Free Will Baptist Treaties of Faith, chapter 3, number 3. I want you to really listen to what I'm reading and let that sink in. All events are present with God. In other words, he could declare the end from the beginning. All events are present with God from everlasting to everlasting, but his knowledge of them does not in any sense cause them. That's an amazing statement, isn't it? Things can happen. God knows they're going to happen, but he was not in control of any of it. That's what it's saying. You see that? I want you to see that. Everlasting to ever, but his knowledge of them does not in any sense cause them, nor does he decree all events which he knows will occur. That's an amazing statement. Next slide, please. For the Free Will Baptist Treaty of Faith, number 9, election. I'm going to talk about both things that we're going to talk about for a minute. God determined from the beginning to save all who should comply with the conditions of salvation. Hence, by faith in Christ, men elect became his elect. In other words, I elected God. I first chose. I chose Christ, and because I chose Christ, God chose me. Next slide, please. It is the I in lilac. I elect God. Then God elects me. Now, Arminians don't like to hear that. You see that verse that they changed that said that God did speak to the rich, which was originally in the top five. Remember the third one? I said it's changed over time. It's because Pelagianism has been around a long time. And so when he went down this road, Arminius did, and began to put these together, that view infiltrated. When he started talking free will, the Pelagians all stood up and said, yeah, but it's not this, it's that. I elect God, and God elects me. And that's the view held by today, by the majority that call themselves Arminians, and it's really semi-Pelagianism. So getting all these big words in it. Next slide, please. Calvinist view. God chose of certain individuals unto salvation before the foundation of the world, which we know is true, rests solely on his own sovereign will. God gives grace, faith, and repentance to each individual whom he selected. These acts are the result of God's choice. Those whom God sovereignly elected, he brings through the power of the Spirit to a willing acceptance of Christ. Next slide. Romans 9, 10, 11. This is a hard one. That whole chapter, Romans 9, talks about the sovereignty of God. And And not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one man, even by her father Isaac, for children not yet being born, nor having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God, according to election, might stand, not of works, but of him who calls. In other words, God chose, and he said, no, I choose Jacob over Esau. They had not done anyone good. It gets a little rough to keep reading. Because one I love, the other I hated. That's a tough chapter to read, but it's the Word of God. See, too many times we get ruffled by this, so we create a God of our own making. And we have to let God be God. Next slide, please. The sea in lilac. I didn't do the other ones because they're pretty, they don't want to argue, there's no really argument to say, well, if they believe that everybody has opportunity to say God, people say they believe that. So, but the sea in lilac, carnal security. Say, why would you say carnal security? Now we think of eternal security. See, an Arminian's been groomed. When you say the word eternal security, they hear, oh, those people believe they accept Christ and have the license to sin. That's what they hear. So if you ever get in a conversation with one, I'll give you a question that you can pose back. Maybe if you learn, get anything out of this today, if you get this, it's a tool that can be used. Because I understand that. I was groomed that. And that's the instant reaction. Oh, eternal security. You believe that you accept Christ and you got to do what you want and at the end you're going to be saved. Of course, we know that's not what we teach. But that's what they've been taught and that's what they think. My answer back to them when they ask that question, I says, I want to answer your question with a question. And they say, yes, what's that? Why do you believe that the blood of Jesus Christ is insufficient to pay the sin debt in full? I don't believe that. And you'll get the hair up on their head. I don't believe that. I say, yeah, you do. You believe in perseverance of the saints. So the preservation of the saints is the idea that we're in the hands of God and we're secure. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the first and the last. He's the beginning and the end of my salvation. All those scriptures come to mind. It's the preservation of the saints. There's even Calvinist groups that use the perseverance of the saints as the PN2 list, which is not correct. I'm going to give you the definition of what one of the oldest Armenian churches in this country says perseverance of the saints is. Next slide, please. From the Free Will Baptist Treaty of Faith, chapter 13, perseverance of the saints. There are strong grounds to hope that the truly regenerate will persevere unto the end and be saved through the power of divine grace, which is pledged for their support. Next slide, please. But their future obedience and final salvation are neither determined nor certain, since through infirmity and manifold temptations, they are in danger of falling. And they ought therefore to watch and pray, lest they make shipwreck of their faith and be lost. So you understand, in the Arminian viewpoint, you don't even know if you're going to get there. Because you're getting there not because of the blood of Jesus Christ, not because he paid the sin debt, but because you are performing and you are pushing forward and you are doing all the things you're supposed to think you're supposed to do, that in the hope that you would have salvation at the end. The perseverance of the saints. Next slide, please. Here's what God says about the whole thing. You want to mark one verse for today? It comes out of the New, I'm reading out of the, you see, out of the New King James. Here's what it says. And it's in that chapter 9. I encourage everyone to get some homework. You can go read chapter 9 of Romans. God says this. I was talking about this subject matter. So then it is not of him who wills. There goes your free will. Huh? That's what he says. Not of him who wills, nor him who runs. That trashes the Arminian view. That's by our own performance. But of God who shows mercy. There it is. Next slide, please. The sovereignty of God. First of all, if we're going to be able to have the conversation, we need to know, have the right definition, okay? Biblical definition of sovereignty means that God, as the ruler of the universe, has the right to do whatever he wants. Further, he is in complete control over everything that happens. Next slide. Psalms 115:3 is what Rod read. Our God is in the heaven, and he does whatever pleases him. Do you think that the creator of this universe and the creator of all us has the right to do what he wants? Huh? I'm not thinking about it. It's an easy answer. Next slide, please. Only the sovereign, here's where I'm going to take you a little bit under thinking. Only the sovereign has free will. And I suggest to you that Adam and Eve were the only people that truly had free will. And then after the fall, sin nature took over. And because their nature was tainted, they have a will, but it is not totally free. If man has free will, then God is not sovereign. Go back a slide, Greg. Take us back to the sovereignty one. I want to read that one more time so that I understand what I'm saying. The sovereignty of God. Sovereignty means that God, as the ruler of the universe, has the right to do whatever he wants. If man is sovereign, if man has a free will to do what he wants and not what God wants, then God is not sovereign over the free will of man, but man has he's sovereign over his free will. Now let's go back to where we were. Only the sovereign has free will. If man has free will, then God is not sovereign. Total free will is, we can say it another way, is autonomy. The definition, a degree of freedom that is not limited by any authority or power. That's to be autonomous. That's to be totally free will. It's a degree of freedom that is not limited by any authority or power. No one has will over me. I have a free will. If God is sovereign, then man cannot be autonomous. Next slide, please. Any view of the human will that destroys the biblical view of responsibility is seriously defective. I'm not saying that we don't have a will. We do. It's just not free. And you see, when we think we make a decision to accept Christ, do you realize that the only reason that you're doing that is because God sparked something in you? He flipped the switch in you first, before you begin to even think or have that conversation. So any view of the human will that destroys the biblical view of responsibility is seriously defective. See, too many times the other side says, oh, you're just like, you know, little robots. You don't do nothing, and God just picked you. That's not how it worked. God chose me, and then he sparked something in me that I heard the message. And I began to think about that. And the Spirit of God began to speak to me. And before I knew it, I didn't totally understand it. I surrendered my will to his. Now, I got up and went home that day at the age of 17 years old and said, I found the Lord. He was never lost. But we do this stuff because we only see it from one perspective. But any view of the human will that destroys the biblical view of God, in other words, God's sovereignty, or call it God's character, is even worse. I find it amazing. I look back from a different place in my life now than where I was. But this whole treaty of Freedom Baptist, you go through every page of this, and there is not one place they ever use the term the sovereignty of God. No. Next slide, please. Sovereignty is the right of God to do as he wishes with his creation. No external influence upon him. And he has the ability to exercise his power and control according to his will. Next slide, please. That's it. We're at the end. Okay. I got an extra one in my head. I have a little exercise I want you to do. I gave you a second sheet there. I want you to see how we think of things and how we see things. Because we had this idea of we chose God. No, he chose us. And then we chose him. Yeah, Lilac says that I elected God.
Wow, pretty powerful, huh?
I chose. Because I chose, God looked down through time and he chose me. That flips the whole thing on his head, doesn't it? Where he says, you did not choose me, but I chose you. That idea of the I in lilac flips it on his head, says, God knew, looked down through time, who was going to elect him and who was going to pick him. God didn't choose it. God had nothing to do with it. And there's decrees that happen that God doesn't even have control over. You can make a statement like that. God is not sovereign. That's why they don't put it in the writings. They can't teach the sovereignty of God because they don't believe it. And so I want to give you a little exercise or something to see how we do this to ourselves. See the page there that's got the point. It starts with Adam, ends with Noah. There's more on that page. I only want to talk about, I took this up and this was given to me, and I just printed that page, so I didn't want to have to do that little extra work. But you see where it starts with Adam and ends with Noah, right? You know that Adam, the word Adam means man. Well, you know the story of Cain and Abel. Cain killed Abel, right? So they had another child. Between Adam and Eve, they named that child Seth. They named him Seth because he's the appointed child to replace Abel. Now, if you go down to that whole list, name by name by name, it's an 1,100-year period of time. It's the chapter 5 of Genesis, if you want to read it. The whole chapter 5 of Genesis is what that those is. It is telling you the names from Adam to Noah. Many times when we look in the Bible and we just think so-and-so begat so-and-so begat and read all that stuff, we just kind of zone out or skip over it. We find it boring. I heard this for the first time when I was probably in my late 30s. I was out in California on business, and it was a Wednesday night, and I was very close to Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa, so I went to Calvary Chapel and attended their prayer meeting that night. And a man by the name of Chuck Missler was there, and he was talking about this. That even in the Torah, the holy word of the Jews, that God does in the naming from Adam to Noah over an 1,100-year period, they gave birth to children, they named their children, and if you'd asked them, they probably said, no, God, nobody influenced me, I chose their name. But when we look back from where we are, that there's a message from God hidden in that book. If you go over where it says man, read it straight down. Man, appointed, and on it goes. There's a message from God in chapter 5 of Genesis. The plan of salvation and the gospel of Jesus Christ is in Genesis chapter 5. Because the reality is, they thought they were making decisions, but God was moving them to think that way. You understand where I'm getting at? That's the idea of the doctrine of concurrence. The best story in the Bible that shows it there, but it also shows it in Genesis chapter 50. Remember when the brothers took Joseph and sold him into slavery? On the human side, they thought they were in control. We're getting rid of him. We're doing all this stuff. They didn't kill him because they couldn't kill him. But see, what we don't understand is even through the wickedness and the evil that they were doing to still get rid of their brother, God's hand was moving in through all that. And he was orchestrating the evil to at the end to bring it to good. And we know, so that's why we have to say, I know that you did it for evil, but God did it for good. It's the doctrine of concurrence. These things are happening simultaneously. When we get stuck just in the human side, the human will, we just see, it'd be easy to embrace that idea. But I suggest to you, only the sovereign has free will. We have a will. But that will is eventually orchestrated to become the will of God. Hope you got something out of that. Okay. Bob, who turned this back over to you? Is he still here?
He's going to close this. You can end it in prayer, Ron.
And when we just end it? Okay. Okay, let's just end the closing word of prayer. Hope you guys enjoyed this day. I got something out of it. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this conversation, but we thank you for your word. Lord, teach us to let you and allow you to be God. That our will is surrendered to your will, and your purposes. For there's no one like you. We thank you, Lord, that you call us to faith. It's humbling. Say, why did you choose me? Lord, there should be no arrogance in any of us, but it should drive us down to say, thank you, Lord, that you so love me. We thank you, Father, for this day. We commit it into your hands. Be guided to these men, but most importantly, use these men, Lord, here to bring glory to your name. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.